Hi, everyone, and welcome to another Take Flight session. My name is Macy Merriweather. I am the graduate assistant with the internships area of the Career Center, and I am here today with Brad Roberts, a cardiac sonographer, and we're super excited to get to learn about his job and his journey to getting this job. So without further ado, let's get it started. And Brad, I'll let you start it off with just kind of introducing yourself and kind of your roles at your workplace.
Okay, great. Thank you, Macy. I really appreciate you guys having me on. As you said, my name is Brad Roberts, and I'm the director of a new allied health school located at Baylor Scott and White, the Heart Hospital in Plano, Texas. We currently have two state-approved programs, adult echocardiography and cardiovascular perfusion. And our first class of adult echocardiography students are on track to graduate in just a couple of months, about 7 weeks, in fact. The first class of perfusion students has already been filled and they start this fall, but we're still actually recruiting for this fall for the adult echocardiography program.
That's so cool. And, you know, congratulations to that class about to graduate.
They're ready.
I'll bet. 7 weeks. They're so close.
Yep.
Could you kind of tell us about a life, like a day in the life of working as a cardiac sonographer and what skills and knowledge you kind of use on a daily basis?
Absolutely. Well, it's use a lot of knowledge about the heart, what's normal, and also the disease processes that can affect the heart, because we're doing a real-time scanning and imaging of the heart with a handheld device called a transducer. And you can guide it. It's handheld. You guide it through the body and image the heart. You can also use color Doppler, like the weather station will do. And we could detect blood flow and see if valves are opening or not closing quite right. There's a lot of things that we can do. So it involves a pretty extensive knowledge of the heart, ultrasound physics, and, you know, pathophysiology.
Wow, that sounds like really complicated to me, but I love that weather connection. Like, you'd never think that weather and the heart would be connected. That's so funny.
Yeah, I agree. I try to make it simple. It's a complicated topic, but I've been doing this for a long time in academic centers. I've done a lot of teaching, you know, at the national level and local. And our first class of five students, like I said, they're about to graduate, and they're all doing exceptionally well. They're getting it. So that's a good feeling.
Good. That is a good feeling, especially as an educator.
Yes.
Could you kind of enlighten us on the journey to obtaining this position?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, it's been a long journey for me, but I'm kind of old, you know, but that's okay. Like I said, I've been doing this 25 years, so most of the students watching this haven't been alive that long. Maybe some have, but I graduated from the University of Oklahoma. I hope that doesn't put any marks against me. Probably will for some, but all that aside, it's a good school. Then I went to work at Duke Medical Center for 5 years, and that was one of the best things I ever did. So I met a lot of people. I learned a tremendous amount about echocardiography, and a lot of it started there. They actually invented the phased array transducer there. I got to work with some of the people that did those kinds of things. And then I met Dr. Paul Grayburn, who's a local cardiologist, but he's internationally known. And I worked for him for the next 20 years doing research, worked at UT Southwestern, and then at Baylor Research Institute in Dallas for 18 years. And I've been here for the last 2 years starting the school up.
That's such a cool journey, working with all those big names and, you know, the inventors of some of the equipment you use and internationally known doctors. That's really cool.
Yeah, it's been a humbling experience. I'll tell you, I've been blessed and I've been lucky, but one thing I didn't do was say no, you know, so I said yes a lot. And so that got me places. So I'm ready to now train the next group of cardiac sonographers that want to do those kinds of things in this field.
Yeah, that's nice. And, you know, having that always say yes kind of attitude, and especially now that you are training this next generation, you know, what other kind of advice do you have for students just now entering this field?
Well, the people that do best in this field, honestly, are people that have an artistic side to them. They're meticulous, you know, detail oriented. You know, if you're the kind of person that you're not, it's not even your house, but the picture is crooked, you just got to straighten it. You know, I mean, you got to do it. That's kind of the way I am. It's the way I've always been, you know, and that serves itself well because we have to measure very small things and very exacting things. I worked a lot in research and things like that. And you have to reproduce data. You know, that's how they study things. And so, you know, meticulous people, artistic people, tech savvy people, you know, detail oriented type people do really well.
So are there any professional or student organizations that you know of that students can get involved in or as they're coming into this field?
Well, as a matter of fact, there's a lot of things that, you know, in starting this program in the school that I wanted included. And one thing I've got to say is the support that I've had here at the highest levels, the president, the board of the hospital, they're all behind this. And everything that I've asked for, we've gotten. And one of those things was for the students to automatically have a membership into the Society of Diagnostic Medical Sonography as a student. So that gives them access to the website and other member perks, also to the journal, and the American Society of Echocardiography for the same reasons. So they can get involved, they can get access to the ASC guidelines, which is what a lot of this curriculum is based on. They can have, you know, member benefits as a student. It's all included in the tuition. In fact, just about everything, I mean, everything is included in the tuition. You know, the cost of the tuition, labs, four sets of embroidered scrubs, these memberships, and also a Baylor Scott and White issued laptop for each of them to use that they give back after graduation. So they can all have the same tools to use, you know, while they're going through this journey.
What are some myths about sonography in general or cardiac sonography that you've kind of always wanted to bust?
Well, I guess everybody associates ultrasound with what? Pregnant women, right? You know, I had to scan some, I had to learn to do that, you know, at OU. The heart's a very specialized thing. So it's not all ultrasound's not just about scanning babies. That's just what people, you know, think about. Any soft tissue, you know, you can scan with ultrasound. You know, in fact, musculoskeletal scanning has become a big thing. They can see the tendons and the muscles, and they can look at shoulders and the grooves. They can look at the lungs. There's a lot of things that they can look at now besides just babies. You know, and there's a lot to know about that. You know, physical therapy, they use ultrasound also, right? But it's not for imaging. They're actually trying to have an effect on the tissues. So they use a very high intensity ultrasound. The ultrasound that we use for diagnostic imaging is very, very low energy. And so we're just trying to see, we're trying to look into the tissues and not trying to have an effect on them.
I had no idea that ultrasound could be used in physical therapy in that way. Mm-hmm. And it's so cool that technology has come so far that, because you're right, the first thing you think of is babies, mm-hmm. with ultrasound. So, mm-hmm. that's cool. Technology has come so far.
Yep.
So if it does, you know, you've been in this field for such a long time. Kind of how does this job affect your lifestyle? And then how do you practice self-care if you do?
Well, you definitely have to practice self-care. One of the things that I teach right off the bat in the fall semester is a neutral posture and how to avoid musculoskeletal injuries. They're rampant with this field because people are not, number one, they weren't aware of it, and it should start in the schools. The schools should make the future people in this profession aware of it. And then, you know, how to stand, how to maintain neutral posture, because you're extending your arms, you're using, you know, awkward pressure, and sometimes for extended periods of time. So people will get rotator cuff tears and things, but I teach them, you know, the proper way to scan and to be conscious of it. And, you know, you can scan your whole career and not have any issues, but you definitely have to be mindful of those things. And I always just try to promote the awareness of that.
And that's something that I think so many people don't think about in so many job situations is you know, the way you stand, the way you walk, and the way you move are so vital to whatever you're doing and really can affect you long term. So I'm glad that you really have that in the forefront of your mind for your students, to kind of have that as an importance for them.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Well, I have one more question for you, and hopefully it's the easiest one, and that is, what is your favorite thing about what you do?
Well, the favorite thing I love about what I do, I don't do as much anymore. You know, what I loved doing when I scanned all the time was that I had the opportunity to look at someone's heart and find out exactly what was going on with that person's heart, because every heart is different. You know, it's like a snowflake. They're all different. You can draw little cartoons about having two leaflets for this one valve, but they're all formed very differently. And you see that when you look at all these pathology specimens and you see just how, you know, unique we all really are. So I got the chance to basically decide and guide the exam based on a person's own heart, their pathology they may have present, and you can document it and prove it and make a difference. You can really find things that someone else might have missed, and that can make a difference in their care. And I really enjoyed that.
All right, that was very, very interesting. It looks like Macy's frozen up again there, so I'll jump in with a quick question. What is the professional outlook right now for students who might go through your school and emerge at the end of that year ready to go on the job market?
It is good. There are, you know, that's one of the reasons that this school came about, is that there's a need for this profession, and it's expected to grow. The U.S. Department of Labor and Statistics look at just diagnostic medical sonography in general, which includes vascular and OB and all of that, including cardiac, is expected to grow like 25% in the next 5 years. There's a lot of jobs open just in the Dallas-Fort Worth area to do this type of profession. So the job outlook is actually very good.
I have one more question. What majors coming out of college are maybe best suited or have the best educational background to be prepared to really succeed in an educational environment and a profession like yours?
That's a great question. And that's one of the reasons that I've contacted UNT and these other local universities, people that are allied health majors, people that are kinesiology majors, particularly, you know, occupational and pre-physical therapy tracks. They have a rigorous curriculum. A lot of them, if, you know, they can't, they don't get into OT school or PT school, or they change their mind. These majors need other education inherently, you know, whether it's to go on to an occupational therapy or or PT or nursing. You know, could be a doctoral degree. This is a great way to go, because they can go 1 year and then come out with the profession. You know, so it's appealing to a lot of people. And in fact, the 1 year can be paid for. The students that are accepted can get a student loan for the cost of tuition through the Baylor Scott and White Credit Union. Also, they'll be approved, you know, barring any severe credit problems, but they can, so then they'll just have to work to live, basically, but the tuition will be covered and everything is included in the tuition.